Today, I want to talk to you about the undefeatable love of God. It's my favorite subject. It's the greatest subject in the world. And let's just pray that the Lord will speak to us. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your incredible mercies and forgiveness and compassion and just putting up with us and helping us daily in our lives. The greatest gift that you gave to us, Jesus Christ. We pray that we could live a life receiving his love and staying close to him. Thank you that you're the one that holds us in your hands, and no one can separate us or snatch us away. We pray that those who aren't yet in your hands or don't know this love, that they'll really be drawn to you in a big way, that we all will. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to cover the verses in Romans 8, a couple of verses there, but if you want to turn to it, I'll share with you a little bit from 35 to 39, where it says, "Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written, for thy sake we're being put to death all day long. We were considered as sheep for the slaughter, but in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate you and I from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Isn't that awesome? That is amazing. Now, marriage and the relationship between a husband and wife is oftentimes compared in the Bible to God's love. And it is a great love. Kathy and I have a great love. And it was love at first sight for me. And it was for her, miracle of miracles. And we've been married now. Oh, hon, I'm so sorry. Let's see. Yeah, it'll be 40. No, that's the church. Okay, never mind. 38 years in March. 38 years, right, babe? I got that. Did I redeem myself? Okay. So, I want to tell you a little story about my daughter. We have four children, adult children. They're all married. They all picked amazing spouses. We have seven grandchildren and one that's supposed to be born on Christmas, which will be our eighth grandchild. All of them are between 0 and 5.5. So we get to babysit a lot, and we enjoy that. It's our pride and joy. Okay. So, but I have one daughter and three sons, and our daughter, Amy. Now, we've always been super-duper close, and some people even call us twins. She doesn't look like me, thank God. She has more of her mom's traits, which is great. A few from me. But anyway, okay, so we're very, very close, and I'm going to tell you a little bit later. She fell into some dark times. But as she grew up, she was extremely athletic. And all of our kids, you know, were gifted in many different things, including athletics. But for her, it went to another level. And so she was this amazing basketball player and was recruited by 60 different, colleges. And so anyway, But she fell on these hard times and made some bad choices and this and that. Okay, so the Lord really started to do some things. And I'll tell you more about it later. But I'll just say that I really wanted her to marry a great guy, you know? And I felt that that could really just help her and bring God's love even more real into her life. So we also have a Bible college at our church, and it's a Calvary Chapel Bible College extension. And if any of you would like to go to Bible college, and we have a year program or 2 years. Anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Just let me know, because it's really life transforming, I think, if God is leading. So anyway, but in the Bible college, there's a lot of great guys, right? And so there was this one amazing guy in particular, a big, burly, kind of a Samoan guy, real handsome and athletic, just like, you know, Amy's very athletic. I know exactly what she likes. And so you believe in arranged marriages here, don't you? You guys believe in that? Okay. Well, anyway, I don't actually, but God did arrange something and I helped. Okay, so I said to Amy one day, I go, Amy, there's this guy he just is graduating from our Bible college, and I was just wondering if you'd like to go to a movie with me and him. I took Dan's place, he doesn't even know her, to ask her out, you know? And so she goes, Dad, that's weird. And I go, that's true. And so, but she said, well, tell me about him, you know? So I did. And she goes, okay. So I called Dan, and I say, hey, Dan. And he goes, hey, Pastor Wayne, that's great. You called me, that's awesome. And I said, yeah. I was wondering if you wanted to go to a movie. Imagine the pastor calling you. Do you want to go to a movie? You're a college kid. That's weird. But anyway, he goes, sure, yeah, I'd love to go to a movie. And I said, yeah, and my daughter's coming. And he goes, oh. So anyway, we went to the movie, and they started to become friends. It wasn't like a big, like, wow, you know, sort of thing. But it's just they started to become friends. Okay, so then they discovered about a year later that both of them do rap music. And they happen to be Christian rap artists, both of them. And so they started getting together and writing rap songs, you know, and then making music. And then they started making music. So they ended up getting married. Now, the amazing thing, and I'll mention this later, God just used him to finalize some incredible works in her life. Plus, they produced up to now one grandson for us, and we're so, so thankful. Anyway, so marriage love is an example. Parents to children love is an example of God's love, but there's nothing as great as God's love. Nothing is great. Because God's love is not just one-dimensional or two-dimensional, but the Bible says it's four-dimensional. And Paul prayed for the Ephesians, and he said that you may comprehend what is the breadth and the length and the height and the depth, and to know the love of Christ, which he said surpasses knowledge. Now, how can you know something that surpasses knowledge? Well, the word that he uses is knowledge by experience. So knowing God and knowing his love experientially in your life, as well as the objective love that he's demonstrated in Christ at the cross, you can know and be convinced of his love. Now, we just read why Paul was convinced. Paul became convinced. And the word convinced, it's persuaded in some versions. Verse 38, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of Christ, which is in, or love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. So he's listing all these things. And he became convinced, he became persuaded. The Greek word is pytho. Pytho, and it means to be convinced with evidence. Well, let's talk about this word but. You know, I have a sermon called The Big Buts of the Bible. And here's one for you. Ephesians chapter 2. It says that we are dead without Christ in our trespasses and sins, right? And we're by nature children of wrath. Ephesians 2:3. Verse 4, but God, the big but gods of the Bible, but God being rich in mercy because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses and sins, he made us alive together with Christ and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places. Let's give the Lord a hand. That is amazing. That's what he did, so that in the ages to come he might show us the exceeding riches of his grace and kindness toward us for all eternity. That's his love. Okay, where was I on the other part? That other message that we were doing. Confident, I love you. Confident assurance. You have an interactive, church. I love that. Feel free. Okay, so confident assurance. Do you have that? Now, let's look at Paul, because all these things, when he says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? He's talking about his own life. That's his testimony. He found it could not separate him from God's love. And then he lists the things in verse 38 and 39. All of that were things that he went through. Let's check it out. Okay? So, first he said, well, let me just start at the beginning about Paul. Of course, you know he was Saul. Saul of Tarsus. He was a rabbi. He was a Jewish rabbi, and he was very well versed in the Old Testament. And he believed so strongly in the Lord God of Israel and Lord God Almighty of the Old Testament scriptures. He believed in the Lord, but he saw no connection between the Lord of the Hebrew scriptures and Jesus of Nazareth. No connection. He thought it was a cult. Until, as you know, he was riding up to Damascus. He was going up there to apprehend and imprison Christians. And a funny thing happened on the way. This brilliant light, brighter than the sun, flashed all around him and knocked him to the ground and called out to him and said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul said, who are you? Of course, we know it was Jesus, right? Jesus knocks him down and then begins to grill him like Captain America would go after a bad guy, or like Jack Bauer. Except he didn't shoot him in the leg, but he went after him. He said, I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. And I want you to go to Damascus. And I want you to go to a particular house. And I've got some people that are going to talk to you and help you. Now, this light completely blinded Paul. So the first thing he did. Okay, the first thing is he confronted him. That's love. He knocked him off his horse. That can be love. He introduced himself. It did blind him. But then he healed the blindness, which is kind of interesting because he had Ananias, one of his followers, a great guy. He said, Ananias, go over to this house. I want you to pray. There's a guy over there that really needs some prayer. And Ananias goes, okay, great. He shows him this, you know, in a vision. And the Lord says, he asks the Lord, who is it? It's Saul of Tarsus. What? That guy's a terrorist. I don't want to go pray for him. He might kill me. And the Lord said, no, I've got it covered. He says, no, I don't want to go. Go. It took him a long time to, you know, he's telling the Lord why it's a bad idea. So he goes over, he prays for him, he heals him. Then he prays for him, he's filled with the Holy Spirit. All of this, all these steps are Christ's love. And then he calls Paul to serve him, and he begins to do miracles in Paul and through Paul to reach people. Then he inspires and anoints him to reach thousands of people with other people on missionary teams, to raise up hundreds of churches. And then he empowers him because he gets put in prison, but he empowers him to write 13 books of the Bible. Now, all of these things and much, much more were Christ showing his love in God's plan for his life to Saul or Paul, right? That was his love for him. God has his love for you. It's not the same plan that God had for Paul, Saul. The Bible's been written. We don't need you for that. But there are so many other things, awesome things for your life. And the biggest one is to know how real Jesus is and how good Jesus is, and that while you're here on earth, he has meaning for your life. It's the greatest thing that you could ever have in your life. So Paul said the first thing is, I am convinced that neither death. He says the first thing is death. I'm convinced that death cannot separate us from the love of God. Now, if anyone knew about possible death, it would be Paul. Because if you read the book of Acts, and I encourage you to do this, or the end of 2 Corinthians 11, you find out that Paul faced potential death at least 14 times. 14 times. Maybe as many as 20 times he should have been in a place where he died. The persecution and the problems became so bad. One time we think he actually did die, but not dead dead, just mostly dead. You seen Princess Bride, right? Yeah, he's just mostly dead. Well, he was in Lystra and he got stoned, right? Not the way you guys think up here, but actually in Washington, anyway. Okay, so he was getting pelted with rocks because wherever he went to preach, there would either be a revival or a riot, or both. And so they started stoning him in Lystra, and the rocks were smashing up against his body. And it knocked him out on the ground, and everyone around thought he was dead. His friends were standing there praying. They thought he was dead. His enemies that had thrown the stones, they thought he was dead. Now, you're not really dead till God says so. In the same time frame, Paul, shortly after, in the way he was describing it, wrote to the Corinthians. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he described a time when his spirit and soul were separated from his body and went to paradise. Went, he said, to the third heaven, which is where God dwells. And he was up there and he said he heard inexpressible things that you shouldn't even tell people. So he couldn't tell us. But it was in paradise with God. It's the same timing as the event of what happened in Lystra. So he was clinically dead. But then his spirit came back in. And to everyone's surprise, he got up. And he went back into Lystra and started preaching again. Now that's the guy, a guy with guts. Amen? Whoa. He had just seen, and he expresses here, death will not only not separate you from the love of God, you'll come into a paradise of seeing and experiencing God that's going to last for all eternity. Amen? That's what death is for the Christian, for a believer. But then he says, life as well cannot separate us from the love of Jesus Christ. And we know that love, or that life, has hard times. Sometimes it seems like life can be harder than death. You know, the sadness that you see sometimes, that you experience, maybe a child, maybe a relationship broken, maybe the loss of a loved one. It's painful, the stuff that we see and that we go through. Just crazy things. But even those things, Paul talked about those things to the Philippians. And he said that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. He said that when you as a believer go through suffering, you're not going through it alone, and it's actually going to bond you and take you deeper into a love relationship with Jesus. You'll be in a fellowship of him comforting and being with you through that hard time called the fellowship of his sufferings. And I love what C.S. Lewis wrote about this. He said this quote, God whispers to us his love in our pleasures, but he shouts his love to us in our pains. Do you realize that? That when you're going through pains, when you're going through the hardship, and it's so tough, his grace and his presence is saying, I'm with you. I'm helping you. Do not think I'm not right there. Because that is his promise. So neither death nor life nor angels, fallen angels, demons, you know, they want to rip you away from God. They want to attack you. The devil's real. You know, the devil was a high angel. He was a cherub. You could say the next one, principality. It's the Greek word arche. He's this powerful being, and he leads a rebellion. And a third of the angels come with him, and they fall, and they're wicked spiritual forces of darkness that are seeking to destroy people's lives. The next word, powers. All of these, they're trying to pull us away from God. They hate God, and they hate everything that God loves. And they especially hate his children. And that's why our battle, we were talking about this, you know, with the married couples, our struggles day by day, they're not ever with each other per se. The enemy's trying to rip you apart. He's trying to attack what is good and great and wholesome that God wants to do. So they're always seeking to do that. But you know what's amazing? The Bible says that even though principalities are powerful, political ones, as well as spiritual ones in heavenly places that we don't even see, but they sort of administrate the universe. They used to do it for God. Now only 2/3 of them do. The others are trying to ruin what God has given. The Bible says that in the end, all of them, everyone, every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father, whether in heaven or in earth or under the earth. Everyone is subject to the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. They cannot separate you, ever. Why? Because little children, 1 John 4 says, little children, I write these things to you because you have overcome them, because greater is he who's in you. He's greater. He's greater than anything or anyone you face. And he's with you. And as you yield to him and trust him, he'll take you through that. So all of those cannot separate us from the love of God. Nor things present circumstances. You know, sometimes you feel the present circumstances are just horrendous, like us in our election, right? I mean, it's like, oh my God, deliver me. You know, it's tough. They've even come up with a new illness that people are actually getting called, what's it called? It's called election distress syndrome, EDS. People are getting in America. I don't know if you guys, you probably don't get that from watching ours. It is a little nauseating, isn't it? I mean, it's tough. It's difficult. Anyway, pray for us. Amen. Election, what was it? Distress syndrome. Okay. People are getting that. Now, we as Christians, you know what's great? We've come to the point where we're not putting any hope in people anymore. Can you give me an amen on that? You know, the government's not going to save us. They're not the ones that are leading us to abundant life. We've got someone else for that. Amen. Jesus said, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And the thing about the Lord that's more amazing than anything is that he causes all things to work together for good to those who love him. Do you know anyone who can do that except God? So even things present or things to come, you know, future things. One of the things that we all struggle with is the future. We fear the future. We have anxieties. One of the biggest problems mentally and emotionally that people have is they deal with anxieties. Right now, with all the ISIS attacks and the wars and all these terrorist things going around the world, you get freaked out. And you fear. You fear this about your family. You fear this about your children. You fear this about your parents. And it's, you know, they did a survey. And they took a poll of all the fears and anxieties that people have. And they, you know, they computed it all out. And they found out that 92% of all fears never happen. 92% of your fears are never going to happen. But you know that saying, dying 1,000 deaths, fearing one? It's like, oh, no, this guy. And then it never happens. But you've aged like 5 years fearing it. Now you might say, well, you know, Wayne, what about the 8%? There is the 8%. But what if the 8 that you're fearing is actually the 92? And it's never going to happen. In other words, cast all your fears on him. Cast all your anxiety on him, because 1 Peter says, he cares for you. Those things cannot separate you from the love of God, but the devil wants them to. He wants you to doubt his love in the midst of those. Nor height, highs can't separate you. Now there's where there's a little bit of danger, because you get so excited and so high and so happy about something else, and you take your eyes off of the Lord, right? And then you're putting your stock in this high, this thing that, oh, it just makes me so happy, you know? And you're almost making that God. This is where we start putting our eyes on things that to us become more important than even seeking our Lord. And you can, oh boy, there can be a fall there. But it can't separate you. Because when you come to your senses, you go, Lord, it was you all along, and I'm so sorry. And it just tells you, just, you know, stay balanced a bit and keep your eyes on Jesus, right? But the lows come. There might be a stock market crash. They're saying there will be. They're saying, oh yeah, the one in 2008, nothing compared to what's coming, you know. Or in Seattle, we just got a report from one of the papers. They said there's going to be the big earthquake, kind of like they say about California. Same thing with the West Coast there in Washington and with Seattle. They say that everything like 40 miles inland is going into the sea when that happens. We're like, what? You know? Okay. Well, I don't know if it's a good way to go. That would be a downer. Right? Yeah. But guess what? It can't separate us from the love of God. Relationally, lows, anything, depression, people in their struggles mentally and the stuff they go through, can't separate us from the love of Jesus. Yeah, do we need prayer? Do we need maybe counseling, encouragement, whatever? Sure. But you know, the most wonderful counselor and the most miraculous healer is Jesus Christ. Okay. So he says all those things cannot separate us from the love of God that is in Jesus Christ. I think of the three Hebrew boys. Think of this. What if you were stolen right away from your home? Taken out of your home, taken to another country, and made to live somewhere else that you were not used to, that had completely different customs, completely different ways. You were exiled over there, and you were forced to buy into their system and their education, and they completely just wanted to re-educate you in every single way. That's what happened when Israel was hauled away to Babylon. And four of the guys that went were Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they were re-educated in the Babylonian ways, and they rose to the top. They didn't believe what the Babylonians were saying, but they just knew because they were good students, and they got elevated to these high positions. Well, you know, Nebuchadnezzar, the king, he's like, you know, I think I want the whole world to worship me. Since I'm king of the world, I'm going to make that happen. So he created this huge idol, right? He created this golden statue. And he put it on a plane, and he invited all the leaders and all the people that could possibly come to that place, and they were all going to worship the golden image of Nebuchadnezzar. And so they got a good band, amazing band. This was a good band today. But even better than that band, I'm sorry. I mean, it's just a good band. And this band was like, and just rocking it out. And they were setting the mood, and people were inspired. And they said, okay, when you hit the chorus, everyone bows down. And everyone bowed down, except three guys. Daniel was away on business. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not bow down. They said, I'm not bowing down. They hauled him in to Nebuchadnezzar. Nebuchadnezzar said, listen, you're going to bow down. We're going to play some better songs. And you better feel the moon. In case you don't, if you don't bow down, we're throwing you into a blazing furnace of fire. That's motivational. And they said, King, listen, we respect you, but our God is the true Lord. That image, we can't bow down to it. We only bow down to one Lord, and that is the true God. And we know he's able to deliver us, and we think he will deliver us. But even if he doesn't deliver us, we're not going to bow down because our Lord is the true Lord. And he's given us everything. He's taken care of us. We're following him. He started popping capillaries on his face. He called the men. He said, stoke that baby. 7 times hotter. He called the strong men in. They came and threw them in. As they were throwing them in, all of them died because the fire was so hot. They threw these 3 guys in. Nebuchadnezzar was so happy until he walked down and he looked in the furnace. He stayed far enough away, but he looked in there and he goes, whoa, didn't we throw them in bound? They're in there walking around. They don't even have their bonds on and they're not dying. It's like a sauna. And there's a 4th one in there. Wasn't it only 3? There's one in there that looks like a son of God. People, that's the story if you're a child of God. Jesus is with you. He's with you in your worst times. And he, in him, is this love of God, and it never departs. And when you're connected to him, when you're joined with him, you're always in his love. And that's why the Bible says, to draw this to a close, but we have one really important point at the end. Verse 37, he said, but in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. More than conquerors. Now, we know what a conqueror is. What's a more than conqueror? The word is literally super conqueror. Now, a conqueror is someone who's victorious when they win. That's a conqueror. A more than conqueror is someone who's victorious because Jesus won. And he shares his complete total victory over death and all of these other forces. He shares that with us. So that no matter what happens in our life, we have his victory and we have his presence. So we win even when we're not seemingly winning. Like you look at the world today, you don't see that Christians are well treated. You don't see that things are just going great in terms of people's outward attitudes and outward treatment of believers. You don't see that. But the real story is at the end of Revelation, Jesus wins, and he's already won. Not only that, but on a daily basis, I play basketball, and I'm 66. I still play. I like to play with young guys. It's so fun. I can't beat them to the hoop, but I can knock 3s down in their face, and I really enjoy doing that. Just give me a screen, bonk. Stefan, you know, boom, there it is. I'm just being stupid, but I enjoy that. But you know what? Playing with guys like that, inevitably, I don't know if you know the sport of basketball, but guys don't like to lose. And if they don't feel secure in their life, and a lot of them haven't had good family lives, and they hate losing, and they will blame their teammates, they'll blame you, they'll yell and scream, they'll do anything to win. Why? Because they are not secure in love. A lot of people cop attitudes and they treat people wrong because they're not secure in love. They don't know victory unless they're winning every time. Maybe you're like that. You know, I'm a competitive person. I used to think I always had to win to have you know, be on top of things. I don't have to because the Lord's with me. It doesn't matter what I'm going through. It's just a game. You know, God is there for us. Here's the thing. Why is it so important that we know and are convinced about the love of God and that we experience it and receive it? Because of this. 1 John 4:19. We love because he first loved us. We love because he first loved us. If we're not receiving his love, we cannot love the way He wants us to love. Because we don't have the love in and of ourselves. God is love. He's the one that supplies the true love. All human love is selfish to some extent. You believe that? It's true. It's true. Now, some is less than others, selfish-wise, but it's still there. It's insufficient. But there's one love that's so sacrificial and so wonderful and so giving, and it's the love that put Jesus on the cross. Because in that, his blood washes away all the wrongdoings you've ever done or ever will do. And everything that's destroyed, what is good and brought hurt, and those things in your life, the sin aspect, he cleanses and washes and begins to change. Change. That was an ultimate act of love. And he rose again, and now he gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit and the gift of eternal life, so that now we can be different. We can be actually become like him. And with the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. You grow in being close to Christ. You abide in him. You start bearing that fruit. It's amazing. The love pours in, even in the trials. Romans 5, 3 says, and we Christians, we're weird. How are Christians weird? In a lot of ways. Weird in this way. Romans 5:3 says, not only do we rejoice in the grace that he's shown us, we're able to rejoice in our tribulation, because tribulation, trials, hardships, difficulties produce perseverance, endurance in us, a strong character quality. And perseverance produces character, proven character, and proven character produces hope. We have hope. God's at work in my life. And hope does not disappoint, because it's the love of God that's poured out in your heart through the Holy Spirit who's given to you. He pours out even more love when you're going through the harder times, if you'll just open your heart and receive it. But a lot of times when we're going through hardship, we put up an umbrella and say, I can't receive that. I'm in too bad of a time. But that's when you need it the most. And I'd just like to end with this thought. And this is the important thought that I wanted to share with you. It's so important that we receive his love. Why? Because unloved people don't have the means to be loving people. You know that? Not only that, a person not receiving love won't be able to give it. Not only are they not blessed, they won't be able to give the way God wants them to give to others. And I'll just sum it up with this quote from Thomas Manton, who is a great Christian writer in the 1600s. He said it so wisely. Love is like an echo. It returns what it receives. Love is like an echo. Now, we know an echo is a noise or a sound that bounces around in an empty space, especially if there's firm, hard walls like a canyon or a cave or a gym. This has pretty good acoustics, so you don't get the echo as much. But guess what also has walls and kind of firm structure within us? Our heart and our mind. And the voices and the thoughts and the feelings that we have day to day. The things that come your way that you read or you see on TV or you hear in a podcast or however it comes. What are the voices and the things that are bouncing around in your mind that you're thinking about? What is it? What is dominating? What's echoing in your life and from your life? And I want to ask you this. Is it fear? Is it anxieties? And that's what you're dwelling on? Is it anger? A lot of guys are really angry. I used to be really angry. Is it concern for your family? My daughter Amy, in the upper echelons of female sports, there's a lot of lesbianism. She was drawn into that. She participated, and she had these relationships, and literally they were so heartbreaking. Not just to us, we felt so sad, but to her. She knew it was wrong. They broke her heart just because they're not God's love. They're not something blessed by Him. Now, there's plenty of heterosexual counterfeits as well. We all know that the immorality involved in sexual behavior is extremely hurtful to families, hurtful to people, and yet God has ways where He wants to provide. And that's what we pray. We just pray to Amy. Pray for Amy, Lord. Just apprehend her heart. And you know, the Lord helped me, because at first I wanted to take a hard line. And the Lord said, don't do that. I want you to love her like your child, like no matter what. And you just accept her, and you talk with her, and you're available to her. And I did, and Kathy did as well. And so we would talk all the time. She confided in me everything. She told me all the things she was doing. It was painful. It was sad. And I didn't jump on her with preaching. I just said, hon, I understand the difficulty in it. I just want to say God has something better. And she goes, Dad, I know. Just pray for me. I did. Well, after a while, she wanted to put that away. Why? Here's why. She had tasted of Jesus' love. She had tasted of Jesus Christ. She actually had received Him, had experiences with Him. And she said, Dad, in order to go this route, go into this lifestyle, I'm going to have to give up Jesus. I'm not going to do that. I cannot give up Jesus. I wanted to jump up and scream, hallelujah, you know. But I went privately in the bathroom and said, hallelujah. And she made that choice, and she started making that choice more and more. And God honored it, and He delivered her from it. It took several years. But the Lord did it. I don't know where your kids are at, where your, you know, people you love and are concerned are at. I just want you to know our God is real, and He is able. He is able. And then, what I told you at the beginning, the Lord brought a guy in, and it's the perfect situation. The Lord just did it. Not all stories have perfect happy endings, and this one didn't for a long time, but it is a happy ending or a happy continuing. I'm just telling you, when His love is reverberating in your mind, when His love is what you think about instead of your anxieties, your fears, your anger, your stubbornness, and all these things that we all have, He can filter those out. And when you meditate on how much He loves you, and you, because He loves you so much, you want to follow Him, He can bless you in every way that He desires. Let's pray. Thank You so much, Lord. Thank You for Your word. Thank You that Your love is indefeatable. It cannot be stopped. And Lord, we don't want to stop it. We want to believe in it, and we want to receive it. We want to receive it. I pray that Your people here could fully receive all the love that You have from them, for them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.